What were the earliest animals like? How did they move? How did they grow? How did they eat? If you want to find out for yourself, you'll need scuba gear and a time machine, because the earliest animals lived in the ocean about 600 to 700 million years ago during the Precambrian. And in devastating news, time machines don't exist and scuba gear is expensive, but scientists might be closer to an answer because there are other ways of learning about the earliest animals. You see, in the Great Tree of Life, the earliest animal is the common ancestor that all animal groups branched out from. Some groups branched off earlier than others and retain more of the traits that our mutual common ancestor had. So to learn more about the animal kingdom, we should look at the group whose lineage broke off first. We can start by looking at five major groups of animals. Cnidaria, the jellies, anemones, hydrozoans, corals and their relatives. Placozoa, a group of tiny plate-shaped animals. Bilateria, which are bilaterally symmetrical animals like us. Porifera, the sponges. And Ctenophora, the comb jellies, which are different to cnidarians even though they look kind of similar. Genetic analysis has shown that Cnidaria, Placozoa, and Bilateria all broke off more recently than Porifera and Cnidaria. So that means if we want to look at the oldest living group, it's either sponges or comb jellies. But, I mean, it's gotta be sponges, right? Their adult form is stationary, and unlike comb jellies, they don't have muscles or a nervous system. At first glance, it seems as though they branched off before those structures evolved. Makes sense, right? Wait. This study says that Ctenophores broke off earlier. Okay, I guess it was them. Okay, and this study is saying it was sponges? Okay, which one is it?
For a long time, sponges were thought to be the oldest lineage, but in recent years, scientists have found evidence to the contrary.
So there are two conflicting hypotheses.
The Porifera sister hypothesis states that sponges branched off first to become the sister group to all other animals, and the Ctenophora sister hypothesis states that it was comb jellies that branched off first.
But why the debate if sponges seem more primitive? Well, comparing physical characteristics to determine relatedness can be misleading. After all, traits can be gained, lost, and regained as ecosystems change and animals adapt. So what about the fossil record? Sponges and comb jellies are both ancient, so can't we just look at which appeared first?
There are fossils of both Ctenophores and sponges dating back to the Cambrian, but sadly not all fossils are created equal, and it's hard to come to a reliable conclusion when soft-bodied comb jellies rarely become fossilized, and when there aren't any sponge fossils from the Precambrian that we can 100% verify as actually belonging to a sponge.
If the fossil record refuses to take a side, we have to try other avenues. If we want to assess how different groups are related, a good place to look is our genes. DNA sequencing has been used to compare the DNA of sponges and Ctenophores with other animals to determine which lineage broke off first, but different models have yielded different conclusions. Some say sponges and some say Ctenophores. In a recent study, scientists took a novel approach. Rather than looking at the nucleotide sequence of DNA, they looked at how genes are arranged on chromosomes.
You see, genes each have their own place on the chromosome, and they share their chromosome with other genes. As genes get passed down, they typically stay together on the same chromosome as linked groups.
The arrangement of genes on the chromosome may change over time, but the chromosome they call home, their chromosome, stays the same. Except in very rare circumstances where a mutation changes this.
For example, an interchromosomal translocation that causes a chunk of one chromosome to be removed and tacked on to a completely different chromosome. It's really uncommon for a mutation like this to be passed down so much that it becomes fixed in a species population. And once it happens, subsequent reshufflings of genes on the chromosome make it virtually impossible for another translocation event to put things back the way they were.
Because these species-wide changes are rare, chromosomes evolve slowly,
allowing scientists to compare the patterns of chromosome-scale gene linkage across different species to identify common ancestors and retrace evolutionary relationships very, very far back in time.
And in the recent study, that's just what they did.
A team from multiple institutions compared the arrangements of genes on the chromosomes of comb jellies, sponges, and some other animals, alongside the chromosomes of some organisms that aren't animals but share a common ancestor with the animal kingdom.
And with this new method, the team found that sponges share multiple gene arrangements with other animals that the Ctenophores lack. And Ctenophores have arrangements in common with the non-animals that other animals don't.
Remember, it's almost impossible for translocation and reshuffling of genes to be reversed, and these events are rare, so it's highly unlikely that groups of linked genes would form convergently in the chromosomes of sponges and animals after sponges had branched off, let alone multiple groups. So these results strongly strongly indicate that sponges have a more recent common ancestor with other animals than tenophores do.
This doesn't necessarily mean the earliest animals looked exactly like tenophores,
but it helps us to learn more about the traits that they may have had. For example, they could have been free swimming rather than stationary like adult sponges. And this research opens the door to learning more about how the animal kingdom as a whole evolved.
As it stands, we still can't say for sure that they're the oldest lineage. Anytime you say case closed on a topic like this, a scientist loses their wings. It is another point for the tenophore sister hypothesis, but scientists hope to conduct more research to bolster their understanding of these evolutionary relationships even more. They also hope to find answers to other questions.
Namely, why are sponges so much simpler if they didn't branch off first? Did they lose traits, or did the traits tenophores have in common with us, like a nervous system, evolve independently?
Regardless of what further research reveals, this study is a win for science because it further develops new, exciting methods of investigating our shared evolutionary past.